Let me tell you about my mini arcade cabinet. So I got this neat little 201 mini arcade game for Christmas. It's pretty cool. 200 games with fully functional buttons, a decent little screen, and even some built-in audio of a kind. It runs on three AA batteries and looks great sat on my desk, but unfortunately, it's not really the sort of thing I'd hold on to forever. As cool as it is to have a tiny arcade machine, the cabinet artwork is pretty bland, I hate having to replace batteries, and I'd hardly ever want to play anything with these tiny little buttons. In addition, pretty much all 200 games are simple ROM hacks of more popular titles you'd expect to find in your dream arcade, and the others are shameless filler or even just duplicates to bump them up to that marketable 200 number. The one part of it I really loved was the form factor, and so I thought, wouldn't it be cool to have a tiny, always-on replica arcade cab sitting on a shelf that played attract mode videos 24/7? It then also occurred to me that I'd been looking for any excuse for a while now to try out the new Raspberry Pi Zero, a seriously tiny computer that packs a punch for simple applications, and so after deducing no user salvageable parts inside this thing, I decided to rip out the innards and shove some goodies in the pie hole. So first, I had to get the cab open. Four small screws were no match for my trusty driver, but the bland sticker decals on the side were still holding the thing together. These soon succumbed to a quick slice with a scalpel and we were off to the races. As I mentioned before, inside there were no user serviceable parts. The entire machine was built around a system on a chip, and that chip itself was buried under a thick layer of epoxy, so there was sadly no hope of messing with the internal files or installing more games or anything like that. I also determined that the mini display, which was hardwired to the PCB, was going to be too tricky to repurpose with something like a Raspberry Pi, so I just pulled them out and tucked them into the base of the case. This would also allow me to test out this 2.8-inch display hat, a tiny touchscreen that mounts to the Pi Zero via its GPIO pins. I married the two, and with the help of some shiny American pennies to keep things on the level, I got to soldering. I haven't yet mastered the art of drag soldering, which would have been useful, but I was excited to try out my new Christmas present, this neat little digital soldering iron from Uichan. It plugs in via USB-C connector, which means that in addition to standard wall power, you can also power it from a USB battery pack for mobile solder jobs. I'll leave links to all these gizmos in the description down below in case you want to buy your own. Soldering the screen to the Pi was the easy part. Now the fun could really begin. I installed a basic version of the Linux distro for Raspberry Pi, now called Raspberry OS, onto an old 8GB microSD card that I had. I put the SD card in the slot, powered on via USB, and was logged in from my desktop terminal in seconds. From here, my first step was to install the drivers that came with the display. You should always check on the availability of up-to-date drivers before purchasing any hardware like this, because it could turn out to be a tiny, useless paperweight without them. A few apt-gets later, and the screen sprang to life. Pretty mind-blowing to be holding an entire desktop GUI in my fingers. When we bought our first gateway PC circa 1995, it took up the entire dining room table. From here, I went through the regular process of getting my system configured, changing the default passwords, installing requisite services like Samba for easy network file sharing, setting up my user account and screen overscan, etc.
What I wanted the device to do was simply play attract mode screens of some of my favorite arcade games in a randomized loop as soon as it was powered up, and without me having to press a button or run a single line of code. To this end, the first thing I'd need to do was to find some videos of my favorite arcade games.
I found a website that lists these small videos that people who build their own arcade machines use as a kind of library of thumbnails to preview their collection, and downloaded around 40 of the best. I found a script that would automatically play videos from a specified folder in a random order, and I altered my boot config to launch that script on startup. So now when you power on the machine, it starts playing back the videos automatically with just a couple of seconds of black screen in between. The other hurdle I faced was that my screen was slightly bigger than the aperture of the case. And in addition to that, I received a faulty screen which developed these weird horizontal lines shortly after installation. Fortunately, the lion seemed confined to the right-hand side of the display, so I killed two birds with one stone by adding more custom overscan settings into my main configuration file that make the system only display images within a smaller section of the overall screen, to the left of those weird lines. Finally, I stuck it all back inside the arcade case with some double-sided tape to align the screen, cut a small hole in the battery compartment for the USB power lead, and hey presto, a custom mini arcade cabinet that plays classic arcade attract mode screens when it's powered on. It's accessible over Wi-Fi to change settings and add more videos over time, and if I choose to go even deeper, I could even install real arcade games via emulators and play them with a Bluetooth gamepad, but that's a project for another day. The next step will be for me to peel off these ugly decal stickers and print my own custom arcade cab overlays. But for now, thanks very much for watching my process, and if you'd like to have a go at building something similar, check out the product links in the description below.